Okay, so this is the highlight of our three-day celebration. It's my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Professor Andrea Ghez. She's a professor at the University of California in Los Angeles, where she heads the UCLA Galactic Center Group, which she created, in fact. And of course, she has many awards to her credit, but the most important, perhaps, is the in 2020, she shared the Nobel Prize in Physics with Roger Penrose and Reinhard Genzel for their discoveries relating to black holes. And in particular, the citation reads about for the discovery of a supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy. So that's a cautious way of calling a black hole. And her work has been in infrared astronomy with the Keck telescope, basically imaging the galactic center and to see through the dust and to see the stars that are going around the black hole at the center of the galaxy, Sagittarius A star. And it's one of the conclusions is that it has a mass of 4 million solar masses. So it's a very impressive achievement in observational astronomy. But in addition, I should add that she's only the fourth woman scientist to win the Physics Nobel Prize. And I should say something about black holes, since not everybody in this audience is familiar with it. And it's also something that is close to my own research, because black holes have come to play a very central role in the recent explorations of quantum gravity and string theory, leading to very deep new concepts like holography. And it may be now hard to imagine that the reality of black holes was in question for a very long time. And it makes for a really fascinating study in the history of science. In fact, the Schwarzschild solution, which describes a black hole, was one of the simplest solutions of Einstein's equations, which was found almost immediately. But there was enormous resistance to accepting what the solution was telling you. In fact, Einstein himself in 1939 published a paper, and the purpose of that paper was to show that the essential result of this investigation is a clear understanding as to why the Schwarzschild singularities, by which we mean the horizon of the black hole, do not exist in physical reality. And this conclusion of Einstein was actually based on an incorrect argument. So it shows that the road in science is not always linear. It takes many twists and turns, and it has taken several decades to establish the reality of black holes incontrovertibly. And the work of Professor Ghez is what has been central to this, establishing observationally that a black hole actually does exist. So sometimes it's easy to forget that it's now accepted wisdom. What is now accepted wisdom was really a matter of great intellectual raging debate for several decades. And I would say that it's a truly marvelous tribute to both to the sophistication and sensitivity of the observational tools, but also the remarkable power of our theoretical understanding of nature, which seemed very outlandish just a few years ago, even to the leading figures in our field. So anyway, I think I would leave Professor Ghez to explain to us all this impressive and dedicated work in observational astronomy. Apart from her, of course, achievements in science, I'm told that she's also a swimming enthusiast and a master swimmer, and she also has an Italian connection. So we were in fact hoping to hold this ceremony in person, and I was hoping that she could visit us in person. So I hope she will visit ICTP sometime in the future for good Italian coffee and a dinner and a swim in the Adriatic. But for now, we look forward to an inspiring talk from her about her personal journey to the black hole at the center of our galaxy. And I'm sure it will be a great inspiration for all of us to hear about her experiences and also about her science. So thank you.
Thank you for that introduction. It's a pleasure to be with you this evening and to congratulate you on your accomplishments. You've worked incredibly hard and persevered in very unusual and trying times and earned diplomas in fields that are expanding our understanding of the world in which we live. At this moment, you stand ready to begin your next chapter, and you have a tremendous opportunity to reflect on your path forward. And the older I become, the more I appreciate those moments in life when you can reflect on our purpose, our opportunities, and our responsibilities. And it turns out that most organizations do some sort of self-reflections to lay out a strategic plan for the next 5 years, every 5 years or so. And early in life, we have an obvious and very common opportunities to do the same as we graduate from high school, as we graduate from college and other advanced degrees. I'd like to suggest to you that finding opportunities for self-reflection might be a useful way to think about going forward. We rarely understand what life holds in store for us too far in the future, but we can assess ourselves and our context along the way to better understand which roads we want to take next. So I've come to think that it's useful to ask three very specific questions every 5 years or so. First, what is it at this point in my life that I truly enjoy doing? In other words, what are my authentic passions and the pursuits that I'm really passionate enough to overcome the bumps in the road that are inevitable along the way? Two, what is it that I'd like to explore that's new that might require me to take some risks in my level of comfort and that might expand my understanding of what I don't know about that I might enjoy in the future? And then last but not least, how can I give back? And in particular, how can I help others in their journey in life? So many people help us along the way. So as we become more secure in our own journey, it seems appropriate to think about how we can help others in theirs. I thought I would take this opportunity to share some of my own journey, a journey that now includes a Nobel Prize. And I think it's really appropriate to start off by saying, I did not know at the beginning of my own journey what I wanted to do in life. I was fortunate to grow up in a family that valued education, so I never questioned that I would go to college, and I was strongly encouraged to pursue my passions. But I had parents who were from very different backgrounds. My father was a European Jew who escaped persecution in World War II through immigration, who was highly educated and spent most of his youth in big cities. Actually, as it was introduced, he was born in Rome, but actually spent most of his youth growing up in Geneva with a small foray to New York City during the war. In contrast, my mother grew up in a tiny blue-collar town on the East Coast of the United States, was Catholic, didn't go to college, and achieved much through very, very hard work. Their differences meant that home was a very lively place, full of passion around the things that they loved in common and friction around the differences in their background. And today I'm really grateful for having grown up in a household that shared a commitment to education of their children for the arts and creativity. But I'm equally grateful for the disagreements as they taught me an important early lesson about being comfortable with disagreement. Being comfortable with discomfort effectively. And I was not one of those kids who knew exactly what they wanted to do, but today I can find the seeds of what led me to where I am today. For me, I find them in three early pieces. At age four, the first moon landings were happening, and I, according to the family legend, announced that I wanted to be the first woman on the moon. Evidently, the job is still open, but these events led me to be very curious about the universe, and in particular, about questions of boundaries. What is the beginning and end of time? What is the edge of the universe? These questions fascinated me, but they also kept me up at night because I couldn't resolve them as a young girl. At the same time, I wanted to become a ballerina, but I soon learned that I didn't have the talent for the latter and got interested in choreography, actually. All along the way, it was clear that I loved a good puzzle as well as a good mystery. So putting together the pieces is clearly what scientists do, and it's also what choreographers do. Today, science has become my profession, and appreciating dance has become my hobby. As I headed to college, it seemed to me that solving the mysteries of the universe was a math problem. So I actually began college as a math major, but I soon learned that the language of math was far more esoteric than I liked, and it was the language of physics that resonated with me. Today, that sounds like an easy switch, but like many of you, there were semesters or so of complete angst about what to major in. And this gave me a wonderful opportunity to explore topics and classes I hadn't before considered. Organic chemistry and philosophy are two that stick in my mind today. When I graduated from college, I knew I wanted to become a scientist, but I also knew that one of my greatest fears was that of public speaking. I could not introduce myself without my voice shaking. So in choosing graduate school, I thought about schools that would give me access to the world's largest telescopes, but I also thought about places that I would not have to be a teaching assistant. In other words, that I wouldn't have to stand up and speak in front of big audiences. Caltech offered me that chance, the chance to enter graduate school as a research assistant, which is what I thought I wanted. And I enjoyed the rigor of classes and excitement of a new research group. But in my second year, I was asked to give a lunch talk about my project. And I shook from my head to my toes throughout the whole presentation. I can guarantee it was absolutely awful. And my PhD advisor insisted at that point that it would be good for me to teach. And this is exactly what I had wanted to avoid. But I had gotten to the point in my studies that I understood that speaking was not just about teaching, but an important thing for us to do as scientists. Now comes the interesting part in reflecting back on this. At Caltech, only professors at that time taught discussion sections. And I had decided that if I was going to teach, that I really wanted to teach freshman physics, or at least a discussion section for freshman physics. At the time, I believe there were no female physics professors there, but I found that I could overcome my fears of teaching by bringing a passion or a desire to encourage young women into the sciences. I'd gotten to the point in my own career where there were very few women, and I could see the importance of having teachers who look like you in the classroom. So I succeeded in convincing the power that be to allow me to do this, and in doing so, I discovered my own passion for teaching. One that, quite frankly, I had not anticipated, and a lesson that I'm so grateful for. Scientifically, what brought me to graduate school was an interest in black holes and an interest in developing new technique for observing the universe. For me, black holes were an extension of my early ponderings about the universe, those early childhood questions about the beginning and end of time and the edge of the universe. Black holes are, on the one hand, incredibly simple, and on the other hand, very complex. You can think, actually, as it was already mentioned, you can think of a black hole as an object that has mass, but no finite size. And in fact, they're incredibly simple in the sense that they only have three characteristics that you can describe: mass, spin, and charge. So if you compare that to the complex set of characteristics that you can describe your family members with, say, black holes are very simple. But if you think about density, which is mass divided by volume, the density of these objects is infinite because you've got something divided by zero. And in physics, whenever you have a number going to infinity, that's described as a singularity, or effectively a giant red arrow that says that you do not have your description of the physical world correct there. So in this way, black holes are complex. And in fact, black holes represent a fundamental frontier of our knowledge of the physical world. This interest in black holes led me at the beginning of graduate school to join a group that proposed to develop new ways of using large telescopes, specifically ways that remove the blurring effects of the Earth's atmosphere to get very precise or sharp images. The scientific promise was that this technique would allow studies of galaxies that were thought to host very large and active black holes at their centers, what are known today as active galactic nuclei. Unfortunately, the technology wasn't where people thought it was today. So I was faced with yet another interesting dilemma, which was to pursue the technique or the science. At that time, I really was beginning to understand that I had a passion for opening new windows to study the universe. I really thought that that was an interesting way to make progress with our knowledge. So I studied, I chose the direction of the technology rather than the science, keeping an eye always on the progress that the technology was progressing to get back to my passion for black holes. At the time, I thought I was really making a left-hand turn scientifically. I chose to understand how stars form and under what conditions they might not or might not form planetary systems. So I was understanding how stars like our sun form. And specifically, I was interested in finding out whether or not they were formed in twins, in pairs of stars, binary stars. And so this was a fascinating topic, but it really did feel like a left-hand turn. At this time, Keck Observatory, which is the largest observatory in the world, was coming online. It's a collaboration between Caltech and the University of California. And I really, and it was just in the early phases as I was finishing graduate school. So what I knew at that point is that what I wanted was a job that would give me access to this formidable instrument. And in fact, as I moved into my postgraduate work, I turned down two faculty jobs to get to a university that would allow me to have access to this facility. Today, recognizing how hard it is to get faculty jobs, I don't know what got into me to be willing to take that risk to be able to get to the University of California. And UCLA in particular was interested in developing infrared detectors, which is key to doing some of the work. So at this point, actually, if it's okay, I'm going to share some slides. So to just share some of this work directly. Okay, so at these are the telescopes. They're phenomenal instruments. They're up on the top of Mauna Kea. And you can see lasers pointing out of that. And that's really related to this development of new techniques. So just as I got to UCLA, the technology had gotten to the point where you could observe the center of the galaxy. And what we asked, that question is there a supermassive black hole at the center of our own galaxy? And this is work that I did with a small team in the beginning. We actually thought it would be only a three-year program. And so it's rather remarkable to think that 25 years later, we're still doing this. And it's a team that's now grown from a small set of three to a team of roughly 20 people at the core and a broader collaboration of 100 people. I'll come back to that later. There's actually two big picture perspectives on why this question was interesting. One is, can we prove that really massive black holes exist in the universe? And here it's useful to comment that the concept of black holes really came from a theoretical pursuit. So that's what ICTP is so good at, is the theoretical piece. And from theory, we understood that stellar mass black holes form from the evolution of very massive stars. But it was observations that suggested that a much larger, much more massive counterpart could exist in the universe. So rather than being roughly 10 times the mass of the sun, these were a million to a billion times the mass of the sun. And it was thought, these were thought to exist at the center of galaxies. And our galaxy is a wonderful place to ask that question because it's the closest center of a galaxy that we'll ever have to examine. The next closest galaxy is 100 times further away. So in doing this work, we're looking for proving the existence of supermassive black holes and ultimately testing our theories of gravity. But we're also interested in a more astronomy-based rather than a more physics-based perspective, which is what role do black holes play in the formation and evolution of galaxies? in the beginning, it was not understood that these things were so closely connected. People would ask, would phrase the relationship between supermassive black holes and their host galaxy as which came first, the black hole or the galaxy, sort of like the chicken or the egg question, which came first. And today we understand that that's actually even the wrong framework, that they seem to form together because the mass of the black hole and the mass of the host galaxy seems to be related. So there's some sort of feedback mechanism that we can explore. So our galaxy is the best place to look. If you look up on a clear and dark night, if you get away from the city lights, you can see the plane of our Milky Way. All the light is are the stars in our galaxy. And what runs through the middle is a dark lane that's created by dust in our galaxy. Dust is very good at absorbing light that our eyes can detect, optical light. But it turns out if you go to longer wavelengths, wavelengths where your TV remote control work, you can actually penetrate through this this dust and actually see the center of the galaxy. So this is why infrared astronomy and astrophysics is so important to this study. It's really the development of infrared detectors that were part of the key of doing this experiment. Another part, which I already alluded to, was the techniques for overcoming the blurring effects of the Earth's atmosphere. And in fact, I remember when I was graduating from Caltech, my advisor joked, you know, that what I had learned to do was take the twinkle out of stars. And this is a technology that has advanced tremendously over the last two decades. So our ability to see the universe by overcoming the Earth's atmosphere has really radically changed, moving from very simple techniques to much more sophisticated, much more expensive, but much more powerful techniques. But you can see that we've enabled our ability to see what's going on in the center of the box. One thing that I wanted to share with you about this work, if you recalling that I had come to UCLA to get access to this telescope and to do these kinds of experiments, but when I proposed the first experiment back in 1994, when I was just beginning my faculty position and I put in my first proposal to get telescope time, it was actually turned down. I mean, one, it was only a 3-year proposal. So here we're doing it 25 years later, but we had a very simple and very straightforward approach to beginning this work. And it was turned down because people didn't believe that this technology would actually work on the Keck telescope. The Keck telescope had new architecture. It's a segmented mirror. So people didn't believe that these techniques would work. So I would say that was one of the very first and major bumps along the road to where we are today. It took about a year to convince the August Time Allocation Committee that this technique would actually work. And we've come back, and we've come back actually with quite a vengeance. So we've become quite a big user of Keck. And it's gone so much further than anything we could possibly have imagined. The approach to this work was to measure how the black hole affects the stars around it, because you can't see black holes directly. So you have to look for their presence indirectly. So the objective was to see how these stars moved on the plane of the sky initially. And this is a quarter of the real estate. I have to say, this is one of my favorite movies in the world. And it shows that you can actually see these individual stars. And while our original project was just to see line segments, you can see that they make complete orbits. Okay, so these orbits are the most fundamental way of measuring the presence of mass. These stars move around the black hole for the same reason that planets orbit the sun. So using the same sort of physics, so in some senses, from a physics perspective, this experiment is actually quite straightforward. You're trying to use basic laws of gravity to prove how much mass is located at the center of these orbits. And then the size of the orbit show you how small a volume, so how small a region that you've confined that mass to. What this work has done has shown that there's 4 million times the mass of the sun inside a very small region. So before this work started, we knew that there was a lot of mass inside a very large circle. And in fact, the circle is so big that you just couldn't claim that it was a black hole. But what this work has done has been to show that 4 million times the mass of the sun is confined to a region or a volume that's a factor of 10 million times smaller, a region that corresponds to roughly the size of our solar system. And if you think about this, I mean, to get a sense of scale, our solar system is dominated by the sun. So that's 1 times the mass of the sun. And we've shown that within the same region, that there's 4 million times more mass inside this volume. And this has advanced the evidence for the presence of these really massive, or as we call them, the supermassive black holes, by a factor of 10 million. So think about anything that you want to increase in your own personal life, be it your paycheck or, I don't know, some other example that you would like more of, and being able to advance it by a factor of 10 million. This is a truly large step forward. Our initial objective that we wanted to do in the 3 years, which was just to measure the line segments, got us the first factor of 1,000. And at that point, you know, that was good, but there were still lots of questions and lots of critiques of the work or the idea that it could be a black hole. And this is where science, I think, is so wonderful in terms of the way it's constructed, because I think that's what really pushed us to go further. And it's also at that point that we realized that the techniques that we were proposing actually worked far better than we could possibly have imagined. And the technology that we were developing was continued to advance. And we got to the next phase of measuring individual orbits, which gave us yet another factor of 10,000, getting to this 10 million at the end of the day. Okay, so this has given us the best evidence that we have to date for the existence of a supermassive black hole, not only in our own galaxy, in other words, in our own backyard, but anywhere in the universe. So today, you know, the question is no longer, do we have a supermassive black hole? But really now, now we've demonstrated the existence of this object, we have a wonderful laboratory for understanding the role of black holes. Now, this is the result that the Nobel Prize was given for. Because the Nobel Prize wasn't celebrated in person, I don't have the picture, but I have one from the Crawford Prize. And the reason I wanted to show this picture was to acknowledge that there's been two groups involved in this project independently for the last two decades, and to really call out the importance of competition, the importance of diversity of viewpoints. It has been phenomenal to have these two groups, in my opinion, working on these projects for the last 25 years or so. The work, although it's conceptually simple, in actuality, there are a lot of ways to go wrong. And the two groups have had different ideas about how to proceed. And while we're independent, the way science works, of course, is that we're constantly publishing or presenting our works at conferences. So we're learning from one another. And there's nothing like a competitor to both keep you on your toes, find your mistakes, and also get most effectively and fastest to the ultimate truth, which is what we're after as scientists. So I really wanted to recognize the real benefit of having competition in the field of science. In this project, one of the wonderful things about advances in technology is that we've actually uncovered more questions than answers. We've found at the center of the galaxy an environment that's unlike any theory that's been predicted for what we should see. We have lots of ideas about the role that black holes should play in regulating the growth and the environment around it. This animation shows just some of the stars that we've discovered. It's color-coded the kinds of stars. And I'll just give you three quick examples of what's been so fun about this. And I have to say, when you find these regions or these areas where you don't expect the answer, for me, that's the most interesting situation as a scientist, to find these things that actually don't work. I've often been surprised, or actually I should say that one of the things that fascinates me is that people outside of science are often surprised to understand that as a scientist, we're most interested in when things don't work. This is the problem that actually, these are the problems that drive forward our understanding is actually when things break down. So what's breaking down here is one of the predictions of really big black holes at the center of galaxies is that there should be no young stars. And here I just wanted to recall that as a graduate student, I got very interested in studying young stars. And what we discovered at the center of the galaxy is that the most dominant population at the center of the galaxy are young stars. And to me, this was also personally fascinating because it was a moment in which an earlier what seemed to be a left-hand turn for me in terms of my interest in black holes came back and was actually quite helpful in understanding black holes, that I had spent a large number of years studying how stars form. And it turns out that one of the things that you'll notice in this animation as it pulls back are that many of these young stars, which are color-coded green or aqua blue, depending on how you perceive it, is that there's these stars form a plane. So in fact, many of the ideas that we think are relevant today can be borrowed from understanding how planets form around central stars, because this looks like a scaled up solar system. So that's an interesting moment when it was really useful to have explored other ideas other than what I thought was my primary mainline passion. There are other mysteries that I think I will not delve into unless people are interested in other afterwards, except to say that this has been a really gratifying experiment because there have been so many questions that have come about from these studies. So it's what I call technology-driven discovery. And it really is like being a kid in a candy shop when these sorts of things happen. Now, let me come back to some final, just short remarks. Today, I find doing research in the university context incredibly gratifying, as I have the opportunity to do cutting edge research that creates new knowledge about how the universe works. And at the same time, I get to create new knowledge in a completely different way through training the next generation of scientists. I love my job, and while I have been a professor for 27 years, my job is constantly evolving as I've moved from being a junior faculty to a more senior faculty. While my science has been very focused over this time period on a single spot at the center of our galaxy, one that is no wider than the width, than a hair width at arm's length, our ability to see this region has changed radically over the last three decades. But over this time, I've had to learn to go from doing my own coding to do the analysis to managing a large and international team. I've come to love and embrace the expression, every challenge is an opportunity, and I hope that I have many more ahead of me. You are at the beginning of your professional lives, and you are doing so at an incredibly unusual time. You have faced the challenges of COVID. Hopefully this has given you strength and a perspective that is different from past graduates. Take advantage of the opportunities that lie ahead, learn from the challenges that you face, and take the time to self-reflect on where you are going along the road that lies ahead. And I suggest once again, these three fundamental questions. What is it that you enjoy? How can you take risks to explore new things? And lastly, where are the opportunities for you to give back and help others along their journeys? So congratulations once again. May your futures be extraordinary and may you embody the changes our world needs. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Ghez, for this wonderful talk, both, I think, inspiring talk for also for the students to see how a major career in science like yours develops through twists and turns, and leading to, you know, major discoveries in science. So we have time for questions now. Please raise your hand.
So there is a question from the audience here. Hello, thank you for your nice presentation. I want to know more about this telescope, because as I understood, you are illuminating the objects with the two different laser, and you're using the interferometry techniques to get this image. But first, the center of a galaxy is very far from us, and the laser can arrive this distance, and it will be nice for me to know more about this. Thank you.
Thanks for the question. So the center of the galaxy, just to give some context, is what we call 26,000 light years away from us. So in other words, light takes 26,000 years to get from the center of the galaxy to us. And in fact, if you put this on a human context, it's quite profound. So if you think about what was happening when light was halfway to us, the first human cave paintings were being made. So we're seeing a history lesson. So you're absolutely correct. The laser itself is not reaching the center of the galaxy. And the current technique of adaptive optics, what you want to do is you want since we don't have bright stars that are near the center of the galaxy to tell us how to move a mirror to counteract the effects of the atmosphere. That mirror is called a deformable mirror. The way you can think about the problem and the solution is that if you think about the atmosphere being like a circus funhouse mirror, so those circus funhouse mirrors warp your image, the solution is to put a second mirror in that can counteract to be the conjugate form to flatten out your image again. So we need to look at something bright to tell us how to move the mirror. So since there are no natural stars that are bright enough, what we do is we shine a laser up into the atmosphere. And there's a fluke of nature that up at 90 kilometers, so nowhere near the distance of the galaxy, this is just high in the Earth's atmosphere, there's a thin layer of sodium atoms that just happens, that's deposited there through meteorites. So when you go out, I don't know, camping, and you see the shooting stars, those are actually meteorites that are breaking up and depositing sodium atoms that, because of the atmospheric structure, gets trapped at 90 kilometers in this 4 kilometer wide, so very narrow layer. So we take these pictures behind me, lasers that are tuned to a transition, an electronic transition in the sodium atom, and force those sodium atoms to shine. So that creates what's called a laser artificial guide star. So we can look at this local, very bright star to help us understand the blurring effects of the Earth's atmosphere, because that effect is very local. So you're correcting what's underneath 90 kilometers, which is the primary distortion for our view of the universe.
Professor Andrea, can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm being connected from Los Angeles, from your neighbor.
That's fabulous. So,
I have some quick question, probably two or three. So when two black holes merge together, do the singularities remain separate, or they also merge together?
They also merge. So black holes merge and create a new black hole. And in fact, that's one of the ways in which we think black holes become more massive over time is through the merger process. In the case of the small black holes, what we call the stellar mass black holes, so pairs. Most stars actually start their lives off as twins. And they're close enough. And in particular, if you have a third body, you can drive these pairs of stars to merge, and they'll form a larger black hole. Same thing with galaxies, is that most galaxies build up their mass through collisions. So two galaxies that have big central black holes in the middle, so the galaxies will merge, form a new galaxy, and the two black holes will spiral into the center and form a slightly larger supermassive black hole.
So two singularities become one. Right.
Yes. And in doing so, they send out gravitational waves. So there's been a lot of work that's been in the press in the last few years about the detection of gravitational waves. So those arise when these compact objects are spiraling in and then ultimately merge. That there's this ringing effect that we can detect here on Earth.
And is the Schwarzschild radius of Sagittarius A star constant, or does it vary? The Schwarzschild radius of Sagittarius A star, is it constant or does it vary?
So the concept, just so everybody understands the question, the concept of the Schwarzschild radius is an abstract radius associated with black holes. And it's actually a very important radius for a number of reasons. It's the last point that light can escape from the black hole. And it's also the point at which, if you compress mass to its Schwarzschild radius, that gravity will overcome all other known forces and force the object to become the black hole. So actually, it's a point that I glossed over in the description of our work. So if you want to show that there's mass inside a small volume, there's actually a goal of getting to within that Schwarzschild radius. So if you want to be a skeptic, you're still allowed to, because we're not quite at the Schwarzschild radius. Okay, but the Schwarzschild radius, to answer your question, is tied only to the mass of the object. Mass is the only variable that determines the Schwarzschild radius.
So new masses are being engulfed by the black holes. So do you think it's a constant radius, or does it?
Well, so if your mass goes up, your radius, your Schwarzschild radius will go up.
Okay, and my last question is this. In case of a planetary formation, only 0.5% of the mass is being converted to energy. But in case of a galaxy formation with a supermassive black hole, like the Milky Way we have at the center of Sagittarius A star, in the case of a galactic formation with an active galactic nuclei, the mass to radiation conversion is 11%. So in case of a planetary formation, only 0.5% of the mass is being converted to energy. In the case of a galaxy formation, 11% of the mass is being converted to energy. That is a ratio of 1:22. Why this huge discrepancy, you think?
Okay, so So let me also introduce some concepts to everybody else. So you've asked about Sag A star, Sagittarius, which is the constellation of the teacup. So if you go out camping, you look for the teapot, it pours into the center of the galaxy. So that's why the name Sagittarius comes up in the discussion of the center of the galaxy. The Sagittarius A star is a source that's located at the center of the galaxy. It's a radio source, so seen at wavelengths even longer than what we're working at in the infrared. It was discovered roughly a half a century ago. And people thought that this emission, radio emission, is associated with matter falling into the black hole through the event horizon. Okay, so this question about the energy that's coming out in a particular associated with this radio source, Sag A star, actually a very unfortunate name. It's actually Sag A star asterisk, because people who discovered it were borrowing the language from nuclear physics, where asterisk means excited state. So what they were trying to say is that the gas was in an excited state that didn't look like a star. So we should really call it Sag A not a star, but our language has evolved to this unfortunate point where we're referring to an object that is absolutely not a star as Sag A star. So what's been so striking about Sag A star, if we really associate it with a black hole, and it is spot on. So in that animation of orbits, the location of the asterisk or star, where the dynamical center is, the focus of those three-dimensional ellipses, is absolutely on this radio source. So we can associate the emission, the non-gas-like emission, with material falling onto the black hole. And what's puzzled people, as you're referring to, for a very long time, is that it's really faint. It doesn't behave in a way that you might expect for mass falling onto or at the location of the event horizon. And this is really puzzled people for a very long time. It's what people call an underluminous version of these active galactic nuclei. And so it ultimately comes to the question, is how does matter fall through or towards the event horizon and radiate its emission? It's thought today that in the center of our galaxy, and presumably in the center of most galaxies, that compared to the range of galaxies, we're kind of a wimpy black hole, simply because, or the center of the galaxy has a wimpy black hole, or on the scale of galaxies, a low mass black hole, simply because our galaxy is also, the central piece is also relatively small. And so the solution to this today's thought, although I think there's still a big question mark here, to have to do with the structure of the flow. In the active galactic galaxies and many others, like the stellar mass cases, there's a really clear accretion disk. So the flow is very confined. Whereas in our own galaxy, it's a much more distributed, amorphous, or not quite spherical, but sort of blown up. So that allows the black hole to accrete in a much quieter way. So that's, in very, very broad terms, some of the thinking, but it is still a very active area of research to understand the amount of energy that's emitted from matter falling in just outside the black hole.
And have you found-
so we have a question from the present graduate students. So let's give the priority to the graduates. Please.
Hello, it's an honor to virtually meet you. My question is about the Event Horizon Telescope collaboration. So when we have a supermassive black hole in our own galaxy, why did we choose to image the one in M87? And do you plan to image the one in our own galaxy? And what can that image potentially tell us? Thank you.
Thanks for asking this question. I mean, we're really living in an extraordinary moment in terms of both astrophysical research, but also black hole research, where we have so many new experiments that are giving us insight. So this work that you're referring to from the Event Horizon Telescope, it's work that these are radio telescopes. So a moment ago, we were talking about Sagittarius star being detected at radio wavelengths. And the way these techniques work is that you have radio telescopes all around the world. So I work with telescopes that are one big piece of continuous, I mean, it's segmented, but it's a single telescope. At radio wavelengths, which are much longer wavelengths, you can actually combine the light from separate telescopes. So you can combine the telescopes that are all around the world. So you make this network. Okay. And in fact, this Event Horizon Telescope originally was targeting the center of our galaxy. They wanted to image Sagittarius star. That was the primary target. And then it was realized that one of the challenges with our own galaxy is that radio source is variable. It varies on short time scales. And it comes back to the size of the event horizon. So you can calculate the time it takes matter to go around just outside the event horizon. That gives you sort of a time scale for variation. And it turns out it's roughly half an hour. And a half an hour is much shorter than the time scale for the Earth to rotate. So these radio techniques assume that the object is constant in brightness or structure over the time scale that the various telescopes see the object. So if you want to do this radio experiment, you have to assume that the object is static or stationary or non-variable on a 24-hour cycle. And that's simply not true for the center of our own galaxy. actually, we've done the questions in a very nice way, because we've already talked about the event horizon, and the event horizon is a scale, an abstract size that depends only on mass. So the more massive the black hole, the larger the event horizon. So it turns out that M87, a different galaxy, the black hole is much more massive. And so the radius is larger, and that corresponds to a time scale for getting all the way around being longer. So it's on order of months rather than a half an hour. And now months is longer than the 24-hour period. So you can actually image it. So it's further away, but it's larger. So the angle is about the same, but the time scales are longer. So that's really the heart. So it was recognized just a few years ago that M87, from an imaging perspective, was easier. There are observations made with the Event Horizon Telescope of the center of our own galaxy. It just becomes a much harder imaging problem, because you have to account for this variation that at present has no clear structure. So they're working hard on it. I think that we will hear more from them over time. And in fact, it's one of the ways in which we have a collaboration with them is that you'd like to do this experiment when the activity from matter accreting onto through the event horizon is low, so that the gravitational effects can be seen more clearly. Because otherwise this accretion emission can swamp. So in fact, you can use the infrared measurements to tell you when the black hole is active and not use those measurements, or at least use them in an informed way. So it's harder, but it doesn't mean that we won't be hearing from them at some point.
And let's take two more questions. There is one from the audience here.
Hi. Nice to meet you virtually. Thank you for this great talk. It's really an honor to ask my questions. As many physicists, I would say I turned to physics by reading about black holes. So it's a fascinating subject. Would like to know a bit more about the mechanism behind the formation of such supermassive black holes.
So that's another area in which there's been a lot of progress. So as I very briefly alluded to, people used to frame this as which came first. Did the black hole form and then seed the galaxy, or did the galaxy form first and through collisions form the black holes? But this relationship that we now see today, where the mass of the black hole seems to be very correlated with the mass of the central component of the galaxy, known as the bulge, suggests that they had to form together synergistically. And so the thinking today is that in the early universe, at the time when we're thinking about something that's very simple, and that you're looking at just small fluctuations that give rise to the formation of galaxies, that process forms both the central core, which turns into the black hole, as well as the galaxy, so that this forms together. So that is the current thinking. Although again, it's still an active area of research to really understand that process in detail, and how that relationship is maintained over time. So it's not just in the formation that relationship, where the black hole is roughly 0.1% of the mass of the central component of the galaxy, known as the bulge, but it's maintained over its evolution.
Nuschia, maybe you can send your question. Maybe you can ask online. Nuschia is a next diploma student. She's an astrophysicist. So,
hi, Andrea, professor. Thank you so much for your talk. It was really great to hear from you. I'm one of the organizers of the reunion that actually led into this ceremony where we're celebrating the diploma graduates. So my question is sort of themed with the reunion, but also kind of looking forward based on all the wonderful questions you started with for the graduates. In my home country, which is Sri Lanka, and in also many other countries, parents, they often would like their children to either work or become something that has direct impact or a more visible social impact field. So for example, to be a doctor or an engineer. And I would like to ask you, how would you suggest how we can convince our communities that subjects like astrophysics and astronomy, or generally physics, are actually fundamentally impactful and can actually make a social impact?
I have two answers for this from very different perspectives. One is that fields like astronomy and astrophysics play an incredibly important role. I often view them as what I would call gateway science. We live in a society that depends on science and technology, on STEM fields in general. And yet we also have a society that's incredibly phobic of math and science. So astronomy has this interesting opportunity of being sort of the kinder and gentler, the one that where kids have always looked up and gotten curious. So it's the hook. It's the way of engaging and educating a really broad array of students about science and technology and beyond, you know, how to be critical about information. So given that we're living in the age of misinformation, I find teaching introductory courses on astronomy very powerful. At UCLA, as the case is in many other universities, astronomy is actually the most popular way of satisfying the general education requirements. I think 20 to 25% of all our students take an astronomy class before they graduate. So from that societal role of educating people about STEM, I think this arena is incredibly important in terms of science education. There's another perspective on this. So if you look at what we train our students to do, there was a little discussion of this just before I came online in terms of what our students do. Certainly not, you know, not all of our students become professors. It's not reasonable to assume that they would, but we actually train our students for an incredibly wide range of fields that find our students desirable and extremely well-trained. I find my students these days often going off into big data analytics. I mean, our data sets are enormous and complicated. So the tool sets that we use are very desirable by the fields of big data analytics. Our students are very well trained in techniques that are of desire to the military. You know, techniques that you want to look up and down are certainly of use to multiple fields, not only astronomy, but communication. These adaptive optics techniques are actually used in vision science, communications, the military. So our students go off into those fields. As well as finance. Actually, we've had a brilliant collaboration with a professor in finance because they care about modeling the stock market as it varies. And Sag-A-Star has such erratic variability that we can borrow techniques from the business world. So I've now had several students be hired in the financial world simply because of their time analysis tools. So I think that's an independent argument that in fact is a great training and a very solid training for a large and interesting swath of industry.
Thank you very much.
So we have the last question, Angie Irfani.
Now, thank you, Professor Ghez, for your nice talk. I actually had a couple of questions, but I'm just speaking two of them. Are we in the observational point of the view? Are we in the point that to test general relativity near these supermassive black holes? Because you know that the Newtonian mechanics works very well, at least up now. And also, can we say that we are seeing just one black hole? Is it a binary black hole? Thank you so much.
Oh, thanks for the questions. This is definitely really where we are today in terms of the scientific questions that we're probing. Roughly a decade ago, it became clear that the measurements were precise enough that other people started to predict that we should be able to get into this arena, that we should be able to get into these tests of how gravity works near a supermassive black hole. And there are a couple that are within reach. So the first one is what's known as the gravitational redshift. So looking at the impact of the mixing of space and time that occurs near a black hole on how photons, light packets, make it from the star itself to us. So those photons lose energy as they climb out of the gravitational well. So you should be able to see that loss in our spectroscopic measurements. So it was predicted. Oh, I should say one more thing, which is to get a seat at the table to do this kind of work, you have to have a clean measurement all the way around of the orbit. And the best one is SO2. I mentioned SO2, I think, when I was showing that movie. Its orbital period is 16 years. So you need imaging measurements that give you the location of the star and the plane of the sky, as well as spectroscopic measurements that allow you to measure the speed along your line of sight over the whole orbit. So that's 16 years. So it's already a 16-year investment. And then the next time it goes through closest approach, because this is on a quite eccentric orbit, then you're in a position to measure this gravitational redshift. So that occurred in 2018. So 2018 for us was an incredibly exciting year. And there were three critical measurements that we had to make within a 6-month period. So it was a really interesting moment in the experiment where here you are, you're looking at light that's been traveling to you for 26,000 years, and you're excited about a 6-month period where you get to make these critical measurements. And you could see it clear as day, this deviation from the Newtonian expectation, and see the effects of this gravitational redshift in 2018. That was an interesting year from the point of view of competition as well, I have to say, because there were three points that you had to measure. The other team went early, tried to convince us to publish together. We chose to wait and get all the measurements. In other words, how many papers do people want to read on one thing? So that was an interesting moment in terms of what really coming to ask yourself, what is your scientific style, and are you willing to wait to get it, to collect all the data, to really see it? So anyway, we took that risk. It's sort of the put your science ahead of your desire to be first moment. I'm glad we did, because these measurements are hard. Now, with that done, the next thing that you can look for is the precession, what's known as the precession of the periaps, which is really looking at how the object itself moves through space-time as opposed to the journey of the photon from the object to us. And what's so exciting about what we're seeing today is the prediction is that the orbit should precess in the direction of the orbit. In other words, if you think about like a kid's spiral graph toy where they make orbits, but the whole thing just rotates like a flower pattern. It goes in, there's a very clear prediction in one direction and in one rate. And that you should start to see as it comes out of closest approach and heads towards furthest approach. So furthest approach happens in 2026. So you kind of predict that you should start to see it, and then the signal just gets stronger and stronger as time progresses. And in the last year or two, we've begun to see a signal. But what's so surprising about what we've seen in the early days is that it seems to be going in the opposite direction at twice the rate. Okay, so we haven't published this because this is the interesting phase where you have to convince yourself that this is physics and not the accumulation of small errors. I mean, if you think about this experiment, you have to put 25, 26 years of data all in the same reference frame or coordinate system. And if you had asked me 25 years ago if I thought that was an exciting topic, I would have told you absolutely not. But it's the thing that limits us, or our ability to understand whether or not this is physics or inaccuracy in your methodology. So as we go on, we can make more and more precise measurement, but it also makes more and more demands that your framework, your methodology is absolutely right. So if you go back and reanalyze all the assumptions, the underlying assumptions, to make sure that any of these rotations aren't from your approach. So we're effectively, the visual I have of this, which is really strong, is like it's going around your car and kicking the tires to make sure that everything, your house is in order. And I find this a really interesting phase of science where you have an interesting signal and you really have to ask yourself, is this physics or is this something that you could, you know, you could improve on? So if you take this seriously, so and I say with a huge grain of salt, that would mean that you've detected dark matter at the center of the galaxy. Now, there are predictions that there should be dark matter surrounding the central black hole, and even reasons to believe that the amount that this rotation or precession suggests, there's equally lots of reasons to believe that underlying assumptions can create such a signal. So like I say, I find this, one of the most, this moment and this kind of moment has happened a lot in this experiment where you really have to think deeply about your results is really thrilling. So there's more to come.
Okay, I think we are coming to close. Maybe I can ask you a couple of quick questions. First of all, how close is the closest approach in terms of the Schwarzschild radius of the black hole that you have?
500 times the Schwarzschild radius.
500, okay. And what are the prospects of measuring the spin of this black hole? Is it?
With Keck, there's not a chance. So this is potentially the realm of this next generation of telescopes. Or any other technique that would get you to orbits of stars that are on shorter periods. You really need to get closer, both to introduce a stronger signal, but also because you want the timescales to be shorter so that you can measure these effects on more than one orbit to make sure, again, that you haven't gone awry. So this is one of the fundamental goals that we've been aiming at with the development of the 30 meter telescope, but you could equivalently talk about the European Extremely Large Telescope or the Giant Magellan Telescope.
Uh-huh, so I see. So there is a lot of exciting science waiting in the future. So that's
yeah. Great.
Okay, so I think we are coming to an end. I should perhaps, you're not able to see the people who are sitting in this audience. You only see the people who are on Zoom. I should just tell you that we have students from something like 30, 40 countries. Not all of them, some of them quite underrepresented in a, let's say, an American university. And we are very happy that in this particular year in ICTP, about 50% are women. So we are really doing well in terms of STEM training for gender balance in STEM.
Fabulous. So,
yeah, sorry, go ahead, please.
Oh, fabulous. And maybe actually on that note, I should have mentioned, in this, you know, along the orbit of SO2, I can often think about plotting my career, but I can also plot the personal events that have happened in my life, including the birth of my two kids. So throughout this, I have two sons, one who's a sophomore in high school and one who's entering his junior year in college. And I think like many women, I've worried about how one balances or does both having a family and having a profession. And I would say this is another place in my life where I've learned in unexpected corners. I think what one learns from being a parent really benefits you in terms of being an advisor and being an empathetic mentor to other people. And the other way in which I have to say that I've really appreciated having kids is through putting them in daycare. UCLA, as many universities have, has a great daycare system. So it enabled me to meet people in other fields, which has helped me both personally and professionally. So I'm delighted to hear that you have such a diverse student body in so many ways. And I hope many of you will consider applying to UCLA in your future years, should you be interested.
Okay, no, that will be great. Okay, so thank you very much, Professor Ghez. This was really wonderful to have you here. Thank you very much for your time. And as I said, you have a warm welcome to visit us next time you are in Italy or in Europe. And thank you. Let's clap.